Hello, my name is Paul Eniath. I'm the Science and Operations Officer with the Weather Service in Hanford, California. Just wanted to put some information out there on a potential tornado that occurred in the Bakersfield, California area. So what happened? We had a potential tornado reported. Here's a link to a YouTube video and a screen capture from it. Let's investigate what this was. Did you watch the video? If so, some things might come to mind, like what was this, where was it, and when was it? Well, the where is pretty easy because the author put where the video was. Here it is in Bakersfield, at the corners of Stockdale Highway and Old River Road. Zooming in a bit, you can see the direction of the video was shot and the approximate path that the potential tornado took. One thing to note is that the Kern River is very close by. So when was this? Very easy again because of the notes in the video. This was at 7:10 p.m. So what was this? The first idea thrown out there was this is a dust devil. Well, we can tell from the video that it wasn't for several reasons. First, dust devils form due to intense heating of the surface of the Earth. This heating is most intense where the ground has a dark color, because darker colors more readily absorb the shortwave energy from the sun. Just think about when you wear a black shirt versus a white shirt out on a sunny day. Which one makes you feel hotter? Looks pretty cloudy in the video. We also know that dust devils occur when the heating is most intense, which is near solar noon. That's when the sun's at the highest angle, and the few hours thereafter. This video was shot at about 7 p.m. That's well after the period of intense heating needed for dust devils. So therefore, we can rule dust devils out. Was it a gustnado? No. Gustnados are basically short-lived, ground-based spin-ups that occur with strong outflow winds from thunderstorms and are not associated with the clouds above, though they can be as strong as a weak tornado. Well, we know that surface winds in the Bakersfield area were only about 5 to 10 miles per hour. I got a map of that coming up that shows that. And there were no thunderstorms nearby that could have produced the strong outflow winds needed. So after looking at some data, we can rule out that this was a gustnado. So that leaves tornado. Was it a tornado? Well, the answer is yes. However, it was what we call a non-supercell tornado, which is also known as a landspout. This is a tornado that develops when the parent thunderstorm is in the developing stage, and that storm is not rotating. The spin from the tornado originates near the ground. This is different from larger tornadoes you'd see in the central U.S., where the thunderstorm is rotating and the tornado forms from the cloud down to the ground. So how do we know it was a landspout? Well, let's look at some data. Here's a view of the Bakersfield area on our radar here in Hanford. The loop runs from about 30 minutes before the tornado to 30 minutes after, and there's a brief pause in the middle at about the time the tornado occurs. The location of the tornado is marked with the home icon. We're looking at four different elevations with the radar to get a better three-dimensional picture of the atmosphere, which is always important for meteorologists to do, and you'll see why. When the loop pauses at the time of the tornado, make note that at the lowest part of the storm, that's that top left panel, there's practically nothing there. If you look at the higher levels though, the highest one being in the bottom left, you'll see bright colors. That's the beginnings of the thunderstorm in the middle part of the atmosphere when it's dominated by its updraft. When the loop starts back up, we see much brighter colors start to show up as rain develops in the thunderstorm and the downdraft forms. Now, we know there was air moving upward into the developing thunderstorm at the time the tornado occurred. That's an important piece of information for us to have, and that helps differentiate this from a typical tornado that develops from rotating thunderstorms like what you see in the central U.S. Here we're looking at the same levels of the storm, but we're seeing the direction of the raindrops, whether they're moving toward the radar or away from the radar. We're looking first for a signal that this thunderstorm was rotating and that would be bright greens next to bright reds. I put an example of extreme rotation to the right, so again, I knew what it can look like. This is from a tornado that struck Joplin, Missouri in 2011. The rotation speeds in that example were over 200 miles per hour. For our case, we know that the thunderstorm wasn't really established yet when the tornado occurred. Looking at the speeds of the raindrops, we clearly see nothing like in the example, and even minor rotation is hard to pick out. Here's a close-up of the lowest part of the storm when the tornado occurs. Again, very weak rotation. There's about 5 miles moving away from the radar and 5 miles moving towards the radar, so that's about 10 miles per hour total rotation. Very weak. So what about near-ground influence? So here's a map of weather observations in the Bakersfield area at 7 p.m. We see there's actually some confluence of the winds. Here these red arrows are showing where they flow and they're coming towards the dashed black line. This would create an area of enhanced spin at the low levels of the atmosphere. You combine that with the upward motion from the developing thunderstorm and we have our non-supercell tornado. So we can confirm that this was an EF0 tornado with estimated wind speeds of 50 miles per hour. Best we can tell is that the duration was 2 minutes and the path length was 1 mile, was a quarter of a mile. If you have any questions, feel free to send me an email. Thank you.